Hi, I'm Vanessa, and I love bad Star Trek. I will be the earwax-covered love glove that is Star Trek The Next Generation. I break down the bad episodes of my favorite show so you don't have to watch it. Yes, I am moving to the left coast, so I'm taking a bit longer to make these videos. Today, I will be talking to you about an episode called Ménage, Troi. There's a bit of a holy trinity when it comes to bad Next Generation episodes, the first of which is the inclusion of the character Lwaxana Troi, the flamboyant, overbearing, and often inappropriate mother of Deanna Troi, whose meaningless titles are even commented on in this episode. The second is the episode-long focus on the Next Generation era Ferengi, who are these short-sighted, con artist, anti-Semitic stereotypes. Like, they are the last outpost level stupid in this one. And by that I mean, I don't understand how Ferengi would be organized enough to run their own sovereign government if all of them were this fucking dumb and bad at planning. Because it's not as though the Ferengi features on TNG are an aberration and the Ferengi Alliance is otherwise, like, well-run. No, they are all terrible at thinking past their pocket. I am glad that on Deep Space Nine this has changed substantially, and they're known for avoiding conflict for their entire history due to their ability to negotiate well. And the third may come as a shock to some, and that is very heavy influence from Star Trek's creator Gene Roddenberry. You might be thinking, how can you say that? He created Star Trek. Like, how dare you? Listen, everyone has their blind spots. On the one hand, it does make sense because his wife, Majel Barrett, plays Lwaxana, is in this episode. On the other hand, I think Gene had a tendency towards the sexually explicit in his writing. Like, I am not invested in his private life, but let's just say I think it influenced his writing style, and not always for the better. Sexually liberated free love planets like Risa aside, the name Ménage à Troi itself, for example, is an obvious play on Ménage à Troi, which means company of three, and which is a reference to a sexual threesome. But the three focused on in this episode are Lwaxana Troi, played by his wife, Lwaxana's daughter, Deanna Troi, and Deanna's then ex-boyfriend slash co-worker, Commander Riker, who were in a serious relationship before their assignment on the Enterprise D. I don't think this image needs to be incepted in anyone's head. And before anyone out there is accusing me of making connections that aren't there, almost every other episode Lwaxana is on the Next Generation, she is fully hitting on Commander Riker, often right in front of Deanna. It just sounds like the product of a teenaged brain, and not in a good way. Like, in fact, a rewrite greatly reined in a sexual joke that I'll talk about later. Just to cover all my bases here, for the record, I know I am absolutely not above making a sexual joke myself. You know, I make them all the time. But here's the thing, there's some kind of finesse, some sort of forethought put into it, some kind of delivery system, some kind of time release capsule through which I deliver said sexual joke, you know. I have plenty of friends in Nantucket, not above it, but I put some kind of thought into it. With what Gene does in this episode, however, it's just he's making his own characters the target of his fantasies, and we're supposed to be entertained by it, but I think the only person entertained by it is himself. That's all. So it was he and his personal longtime secretary, Susan Sackett, who wrote this together. And she doesn't strike me as a writer, just a hunch. For example, she said, quote, "It's a comedy, not Shakespeare." But Shakespeare wrote comedies. Quite a few, in fact. As You Like It, The Comedy of Errors, Love's Labor's Lost, Measure for Measure, The Merchant of Venice, The Merry Wives of Windsor, A Midsummer Night's Dream, Much Ado About Nothing, The Taming of the Shrew, The Tempest, Twelfth Night, Two Gentlemen of Verona, A Winter's Tale. But what's even stranger about that statement is that Picard literally quotes Shakespeare sonnets in the episode, almost as a way to take jabs at Patrick Stewart's Shakespearean acting pedigree. So what point was she trying to make? That comedy is somehow low effort? What truly is effortless is misogynist messaging. Like, it is so easy to take swings at mother-daughter relationships. See, women never get along, ha ha ha, when rivalry, even of this type, is the result of patriarchy. It's also effortless to rely on anti-Semitic stereotypes. What no one wants to admit, like white guys with podcasts, is that stereotype-based comedy is pretty fucking boring because it's so easy. And so is this. So it's bad. The opening in 10 Forward, though, is kind of cute. The Enterprise D is hosting a Beta Z trading conference between the telepathic Betazoids and the Ferengi, and I do honestly enjoy watching Riker play 3D chess. But of course, the Ferengi has to be a sore loser.
It's unfair. I couldn't concentrate with all that noise.
Noise? It's Algolian ceremonial rhythms.
And I like how Starfleet Wesley's response is too. Unfortunately, because the guy running the trade conference is Betazoid and they're in orbit above Beta Z, this somehow means that Lwaxana must be there. That justification seems mighty flimsy to me. And Picard's comment that, oh, Deanna must love that she's visiting with her mother, is an obviously stupid one, because that's never been true. Their relationship has never changed, which is clear with how hard Deanna's sucking down highballs, which must be made of actual alcohol, trying to numb the pain of her mother lecturing her about what she should be doing with her life, which is leave Starfleet, get married, and have kids.
You've got to enjoy life, relax, like I do. Find yourself the right man. Think of your future. Think of my future.
Like, Deanna is a counselor on the flagship of Starfleet and is regularly on the bridge assisting Captain Picard with especially hairy situations. Why is no part of her proud of her daughter or willing to recognize what she's accomplished? At the bar, meanwhile, the Ferengi are checking out Lwaxana, who, to be fair, is looking very nice. And one of them makes a comment about how her Betazoid telepathy would be an asset during negotiations with competitors.
She's as repulsive as the rest of them.
Repulsive? I find her exotic. And what an advantage her telepathy would be in our negotiations.
To read our competitors' minds.
But no, that's actually not true. At least with other Ferengi, which is what Ferengi mostly deal with. Because it's even mentioned just a minute before in this very episode that Betazoids are uncomfortable around Ferengi because they cannot read their minds. So the plot seed that's meant to germinate later in the episode is essentially planted in a fallow field. In other words, the stakes make no sense. Damon Togg does a Picard tug on his little crop top and saunters over to Lwaxana to introduce himself, and she uses Picard as an excuse to get away from him, and then Picard goes, I gotta show this guy I just met the new doorknobs on the elevator, so I gotta scram. Duty calls, so then Damon seizes the opportunity and tries again with Lwaxana using a more direct approach and even offering to pay handsomely for her, which goes as expected.
You must be aware that every female has her price.
Let's get one thing straight, little man. I am not for sale. And if, by some chance, I were to become available, I would rather eat Orion wing slugs than deal with a toad-faced troll like you!
No disrespect to sex workers, of course, but assuming that every single woman that they meet is a sex worker for the right price really is a taste of how commodified every one and everything is to a Ferengi. But even they should know that a high-ranking Betazoid is not going to agree to this, but he is absolutely not discouraged.
Now I want her more than ever, Lwaxana Troi. You will be mine.
I'm also confused about why Deanna's embarrassed by her mom telling off Damon. Her mom did just have to deal with someone trying to buy her. But their relationship cannot, absolutely cannot have any other dynamic besides loud and overbearing mom and eye-rolling pubescent daughter embarrassed by said mom. Even back in Lwaxana's quarters, Lwaxana continues her campaign for Deanna to get married, even using the tried and true toxic tools of guilt and hostility.
Deanna, try to understand. You're all I have. My only concern is for your happiness.
I am happy. Why can't you believe that?
Oh, I wish I could.
So there does not appear to be any love or respect at the core of this tension. As a result, they make both Lwaxana and Deanna unwatchable stereotypes when they're together, saying things like, why do something where you're always there for others and never for yourself? How does having a child not involve being selfless and sacrificing yourself? That makes no sense at all. And stating that Deanna had her chance for family life with Commander Riker, but fuck that up.
But you have to let me make my own choices, live my own life, and not the life that you would choose for me.
You had your chance with Commander Riker. Look how you ruined that.
Like, that is way, way below the belt and a deeply shitty thing for her to say. Like, this conflict itself feels so forced too. Where does this fight even come from? Like, think about the Bechdel test too, where two women alone in a scene talk about anything other than men and how, like, they are reaching like someone shorter than 5 foot in the canned food aisle to fail it. And I love how her mom is like, just get a husband, like it's that easy. Did she forget that she watched Deanna fully get stood up by a guy that she was actually arranged to marry? And it was because this guy Wyatt just so happened to run into the woman that he had been drawing for his entire life. And he kept those drawings right by his bed for purely Christian reasons, I'm sure. Like, I am not a spiritual person by any stretch of the imagination, but if that happened to me, I'd be like, you know what? Maybe God wants me to be single forever. Contrast this with the level-headed tea sipping in Picard's ready room, where Wesley is being congratulated for getting into Starfleet Academy. See, notice the difference. Men lift each other up, at least professionally, while women will rip each other apart. Beverly Crusher, for example, never ever would think to sit down Wesley and go, you know, I know you really want to be a cadet, but when are you gonna get married? When am I gonna have grandbabies? Like, this whole career thing is just cute, but it's in the way of what you really should be doing. And he is also an only child, so there's that same impetus, but he still manages to have his choices respected. The episode takes another turn when Riker and Troi beam down to Beta Zed's surface to reminisce and share a tender moment, but of course, guess who shows up? Miss Pain of the Ass of the Fifth House, heir to the holy rings of Beta Zed, which is redundant because all rings are holes, right? Her fucking mom, who starts an impromptu picnic. And there's this odd beat where Lwaxana feeds a lettuce leaf called an oscoid to Riker. So this is the joke that I was referring to earlier. Gene Roddenberry originally wrote for the oscoid to be more of a cucumber, which would make this comment.
See, that sap running through the veins helps keep it warm.
Absolutely gross. That's puerile and nasty. Left in, this would be yet another sexual invitation from a potential mother-in-law. Okay, Gene, we get it. You have a porn preference. Thank you for that image. Just in the nick of time, Damon Togg shows just how big of an idiot he is by beaming down and kidnapping Riker, Troi, and Lwaxana back to his ship. This is not a good plan because Riker is second in command of the Enterprise, the flagship of Starfleet, and Deanna's the head counselor of the same vessel. Lwaxana is also Beta Zoid royalty. So in what universe does he think he's going to get away with this? He will be caught. It is only a matter of time. Also, the Ferengi had just cut a deal with the Beta Zoids. So how is this gonna help maintain that business relationship? Like, what is the point? The point appears to be to have both Lwaxana and Deanna beamed into another room in a state of undress, which is weird. Ferengi don't believe women should wear clothing. I'm not clear on whether this is the first time it's mentioned, but again, this is just so obviously the writer is deciding to make it sexual in this forced and tasteless way. They get into drag race mini challenge, quick drag using sheets, and both of them end up in regular clothes again eventually, probably because it wouldn't be network safe to keep them naked the whole time. But the random costume changes weren't really explained and didn't do anything stakes-wise. Damon forcing Lwaxana to help him with her powers. Again, this isn't gonna help with any other Ferengi, but whatever. Gives Lwaxana the opportunity to exploit Damon to somehow get them out of this pickle. And he wastes no time popping out the futon from the wall, but she telepathically lets Deanna know that she's got it handled, while Riker psychs out his captors by reminding them how he completely creamed them in 3D chess. But then we have to watch a disgusted Lwaxana kiss Damon Tog on the lips. Call me old-fashioned, but I don't find sexual coercion to be funny. And it's weird that the show is trying to convince you that it is. Like, of course, men and then women with internalized misogyny would think that being abducted and made to kiss someone you're not attracted to for survival is just hilarious. What's hilarious is that Picard hasn't even thought to check in with Riker or Troi on the surface of Beta Z while staring at a rare phenomenon. Like, you can see it in his face. Like, thank God that bearded, horny riffraff and that touchy-feely counselor are out of here. I can finally drink in this moment unencumbered. And that moment turns into a verp, also known as a vomit burp, while Lwaxana performs the first example of umox that we see on Star Trek, which is a Ferengi ear job.
No one has ever given me umox like this before.
Umox?
There's no translation, but the ear is one of our most erogenous zones.
And Riker convinces one of the jailers to let him out of his cell in order to continue playing chess because, duh, they're that stupid and prideful, who he, of course, knocks out and uses the bridge panel to send a message back to the Enterprise.
Little one, if Tog were a kitten, he'd be purring.
Good work, mother.
Which he can't do without a code from Damon. So now Lwaxana has to give a guy an ear job for long enough to get that code, which isn't even necessary, honestly, because Beta Z eventually contacts the Enterprise and lets them know that their friends have been abducted. And Lwaxana tries to use making a drink as a ruse to get a code, which I don't understand how that works. But then the other Ferengi, who, by the way, is played, I believe, by Ethan Phillips, who also plays Neelix in Voyager, and he is like, you know, the ear job has clearly scrambled your brain, so how about we scramble her brain and use mind probes to map out why she is telepathic? But this could kill her. Killing Betazoid royalty would paint an even bigger target on themselves. Beta Z might even consider that an act of war. So this is an even worse plan. So when Data finds the ugly Ferengi bouquet on the Beta Z surface, of course, Wesley Crusher pulls one more Wunderkind magic trick to narrow down where the Kraton is, because Riker used the hot tune played by the guy earlier in the episode to send the message.
But listen to the pattern. It's the Algolian ceremonial rhythm that the musician played at the reception.
Mr. Crusher is correct, sir. There is a temporal correlation.
And Deanna and Riker rescue Lwaxana from the Mind Masher, and Lwaxana decides to negotiate a deal where they let Riker and Deanna go. Why Riker simply doesn't use his phaser to take the ship over, I don't really understand. Nobody's choices make any sense here. Like, where would Damon even send them? How does keeping Lwaxana captive no longer make them a target? But the Enterprise shows up just in time to have them beamed over, and I guess the Federation's okay with sex slavery, so they're convinced that Lwaxana's fine, Maybe that's the assumption they're going on. But of course, they're not going to just leave her there. And their plan doesn't simply involve asking for Lwaxana to be beamed over, or they're going to be in deep shit with both Beta Zed and the Federation. No, it's Picard quoting Shakespeare sonnets to convince Daemon that he's in love with Lwaxana, which is meant to convince him to forfeit the love war that never was established.
'Tis better to have loved and lost than never to have loved at all.
It's supposed to be funny that Picard says that he loves someone that has repeatedly made him uncomfortable in the past in order to save her life. But what really convinces Daemon in the end is that he counts down from 10, saying that when he gets to 1, he's gonna destroy the Kraton with full phasers, even with Lwaxana on board. What the fuck was that about? Deanna still thinks her mom is a loudmouth embarrassment. Lwaxana seems to get over being sex trafficked rather quickly, and Riker continues to beard it up on the bridge. They broke even. Except for Wesley's advancement, which was met with nothing but support from all sides. Like, there was a little bit of a conflict when he just didn't beam over to a ship in time, but he can just beam over to another one some other time. It was really forced stakes. I wish we got to see Lwaxana see Deanna as an adult, but that would mean the writers would think of women aging emotionally past 13, and that's not gonna fucking happen, so nothing matters. So this is quite skippable. Like, subscribe, no pressure, but peer pressure. Till next time, I guess.